there.
Oh.
Now we're
Hello, I'm Bill Olson, and we have a special show today on Free Speech Zone. Basically, I want to make one disclaimer first. Like Jon Stewart says, he's a comedian, not a newsman, and that's his excuse. my excuse, I'm not a journalist. I'm a photographer first, I'm a ham operator second. You know, I have a whole bunch of things before I'm a journalist. And so I might not be doing very well as an interviewer, but we have today a special guest formerly from Lewis and Clark College. It's Professor Zaher Wahab, and he's now affiliated with the American University of Afghanistan, and in Kabul. And he's been on one of my photography mailing lists, and we've been keeping in touch that way. And recently he put me on his mailing list for his newsletter that he sends out once in a while, and I'm totally ignorant about things that, you know, you have to concentrate on things at the time. And anyway, my interest never included learning about Afghanistan except for the way that we've abused it as the United States. And to start out, I was really surprised to find out that it doesn't have a reason to exist as a country. It's a buffer zone. And can you explain what you were saying?
Well, many people in it's a historical fact that although the land and the people were there for maybe 5,000 years or so, it goes back to BC era. But Afghanistan as a nation state was created through an agreement between the British empires when they were in the Indian subcontinent, mm-hmm. and Tsarist Russia. The two empires didn't want to collide directly, so it is said that the two of them agreed and carved out this area called Afghanistan. And you can see that, you know, one, as we were talking earlier, it is a landlocked country, mm-hmm. which is to say it is sort of an artificial creation. And two, if you go to Afghanistan now, it is the most diverse country perhaps in the world in terms of ethnicity, people's features, religion, you know, geography, the landscape, etc. So that's why, you know.
It seems like it seems like a chess piece in everybody else's game, and the poor people that live there continually bleed for everybody else.
Yes, well, as you probably know, Alexander the Great went through there and occupied the country in 300 and something BC, and apparently he died there. And then Genghis Khan, you know, the Timurlane, and then the British, then the Russian most recently, and then now the Americans. Now, you said you were not a trained journalist, but I would say, but you are a concerned citizen.
I think
we need more concerned citizens.
These are just questions that everybody should be asking. You know,
yes.
Why do people sit there? Oh, I don't want to know about that. I don't know.
Yeah.
Everything's going okay in my life.
Yes.
You know.
Well, and actually, you know, I've been back for about 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. I was gone for 11 months this time. And I've been back in this country for 2 weeks. And it really astonishes me that so little is mentioned of Afghanistan and about Afghanistan.
Oh, but we know everything about America's Got Talent.
Yeah.
I tell people all the time, hey, I can't talk about that right now. I got to go.
Yes.
You know, Dancing with the Stars is on.
Yes, yes. people have other preoccupations.
Yeah. Or they know every statistic about a basketball player.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, but it's, you know, it's so important because the United States still spends money in Afghanistan.
Yeah, by
and
the
it still
billions.
Sheds blood in Afghanistan, and Americans still get killed. And there are at least 20,000 Americans between the military, the civilians, and not counting the contractors, like Blackwater, DynCorp, and so forth. So there are literally tens of thousands of Americans right now doing or undoing all kinds of things, and we do spend money. And now with the arrival of Daesh or ISIS into Afghanistan, you know, there's a new challenge.
Islamic State, Iran, and...
ISIS, the Islamic State of Iran, Iraq, and Syria.
Iraq and Syria,
yeah,
okay.
The
yeah.
Islamic State of Iraq and Syria. You know, and they're a serious challenge, although their origin is kind of obscure. People are not quite sure how ISIS came about.
I know we've talked about how, you know, some of its evolution from Al-Qaeda and how Americans were in charge and control.
Yeah.
But that, if you look at the people who are fighting in those organizations, they don't necessarily know that, right?
No, the rank and file in particular.
They're fighting seriously for their own beliefs.
Yes.
And those are being totally manipulated by the power structure that's arming them, us.
Yeah.
I mean, right now, is that right?
Yes. I mean, you know, and many people really believe, and people who are even educated in this country, seriously believe that Qaeda was an American-Israeli creation. We all know, of course, that the Taliban were an American, Saudi, and Pakistani creation.
It's very hard for Americans to understand because our news people use those words interchangeably as the enemy. You know,
and we
don't know where they came from or what they are.
Yes. And so people now believe that, you know, the Taliban and Al-Qaeda are sort of spent, you know, cliches.
Their old history.
And their history in a way, and that the West,
we have
and,
new
but America
worries.
Needs a new reason to invade or reinvade that part of the world.
I've often written that, and I characterized it as America is the corrupt glass company owner who hires juvenile delinquents to go break windows at night so we can go in and fix the windows.
Yes.
And so every time we have we find some country that we want either to control or take their natural resources, we send in Al-Qaeda, and then we announce, we will save you from Al-Qaeda.
Yes.
And by now, if there's anybody in the world that doesn't know that, it's their own fault.
You would think.
I think so.
Yes, you would think.
There are sources. I know it, and I'm a photographer or a ham radio operator or something. How do I know any of this stuff?
Wait.
Because it's there. Yeah. You can find it.
People believe.
It's your show.
People do believe that ISIS is sort of an American Western invention in part to justify a permanent American presence in the Middle East.
Right, that's the other half. We build
keep
permanent
the Chinese
bases.
Away at bay, keep the Russians at bay, keep Iran, you know, controlled, because there are enormous resources. You know, there are resources, oil, gas,
counting what we spend on NATO and all that, we have Russia completely surrounded with what you said the other day, 700 military bases.
Yes.
I know the number's been as high.
Yes.
I've heard
but
as high
But part
as
of it is also, they say, to frighten the American public. So you talk about Daesh as if they were...
Oh, we're so afraid. You go ahead and do whatever you have to do to save us.
I would manage the foreign
policy.
Keep
us safe. Right.
Yes. And people are afraid. It's really...
I just heard them talking about, the Republicans will save us from Obama.
Yes.
Well, wait a minute.
Yeah.
Whoever they... It doesn't matter if you elect somebody from the Republicans, they're going to come in and do exactly the same thing that Obama's doing because they're only representing the decisions of the elite.
Yes. But also, it's interesting. I mean, it's almost comic. If it weren't so tragic that...
You have to have a sense of humor just to keep...
So ISIS, the label applies to some people. There are some bad people there in the world, you know, who behead people, you know, butcher people and so forth.
And we make a point of finding them to work for us.
But you need... and, you know, the recent conference was to mobilize all of NATO to fight, let's say, maybe 4,000 ragtag, you know, guerrillas.
Right, and we don't know where they are.
That's
we don't. They don't have a headquarters
on.
But we're going to mass the whole world against them.
Yeah.
What?
This in itself should raise question in people's minds.
It's just a continuation of the drug war. The communists. Remember, communists were under your bed.
Yes.
And of course,
yes.
All that was just a way of organizing money. Yes. For somebody else.
Speaking of drugs. In drug wars, remember that was one of the justification for the Afghan invasion and occupation.
I think what they meant was we have to protect the poppy fields to maximize.
In fact, by default, the American presence has made the drug issue much, much worse.
Right.
This year was a bumper year. And the cigar reports, John Sopko, the American Inspector General, says the United States has so far spent $8 billion on the drug war in Afghanistan, but the outcome has been a monumental increase in drug production,
right.
drug trade, and drug use in Afghanistan. So that's the drug part of it. The other was, of course, to fight terrorism, global terrorism, remember?
And these are terms that are not even defined.
Right,
they don't even define
right,
them in their right. own law.
Right, right.
And
but if you're
that's
talking
not a
about
coincidence,
threats,
folks.
You know, to human life, it has multiplied 100 times. So
yes.
the question would be, you know, what is this all about? But at the same time, the U.S. State Department just issued an advisory to Americans to stay away from Afghanistan just last week. So we have spent $1 trillion, about 150,000 Americans have served there, and now you're telling me that you can't even visit the country.
Right.
So what was this all about? What about all of the, you know, the death and destruction and the expenses?
Well, wait a minute.
And all
the hype. There is yeah. a positive outcome.
Yeah.
The United States corporations have secured the lithium fields there,
yeah.
haven't
yeah.
they? Or
yes.
whatever, lithium
yes.
mines?
Yes,
and
yes.
Then,
the gold mines,
yeah,
the copper mines, the silver,
why, we're
the
so,
uranium.
We're so nice to people who
yes.
mine gold. We just,
yeah.
what, 5 or 10 years ago,
right.
gave these billions of dollars of gold fields in Montana to a yeah. Canadian company for $50,000 right. or some ridiculously yeah. low fee.
Yeah.
And, you know, we don't expect any other return from
yeah.
it.
Yeah. But you know, American
nice.
Companies
yeah.
are prospecting, you know.
You
now
bet.
They're negotiating about mines, you know, oil, gas, coal, you name it. So it's not, I think, so much Afghanistan per se that the United States or the West are worried about. I think countries are protecting their own interests and they're promoting their own interests.
Sure.
And one of the American strategy, of course, is again to push back China and Russia as far as they can.
I think it's being counterproductive,
but this is dangerous.
Now, because they're pushing back.
It's also dangerous.
Yeah.
There is a pushback. You know, I mean, this could lead to a war, you know, inadvertently.
And now we have our scientists, or at least our military salesmen,
yes.
describing nuclear bombs that were detonated slightly under the ground
yes.
as being safe for civilian populations because
yes.
they're lying.
Yes.
That's as simple as that. They're just lying.
Yes, 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 yes.
But it puts an atmosphere that
yeah.
lets these guys, the lower level people that are
yeah.
trying to work out strategies
yes.
for their battles,
yes.
well, now we have a tool that we can use.
Yes.
Hey,
yes.
you know.
Yes.
Oh my God, we're going to leave.
So these.
But that's we're doing it on a slow basis with depleted uranium in every round we shoot everywhere.
Yeah, that's right.
It's
right.
obscene. Yeah. Oh God.
The citizens throughout the world, I mean, the way I see it, Bill, is that there's just trouble all over the world.
It's going to last centuries
people,
with
common
these
people
things,
suffer.
Yeah.
You know, so the way Americans, even the middle class, suffer is they're squeezed economically. You know, all of the low wages, all of the homelessness, you know, all of the bad schools, bad roads, bad bridges.
I was forced out of my house for $7,000 in property tax.
Right, right.
Thank you,
so
America.
Americans, in a way, pay for it in this way, and this has, of course, side effects. When people have difficulties, economic difficulties, it has all kinds of psychic, social, family ramifications. At the other end, of course, that a lot of people are just killed. You know, a major study by the Physician for Social Responsibility and by Brown University state that the United States, that since 2001, the invasion of 2001 of Afghanistan, more than 200,000 Afghans have been killed. You know, that's a lot of people for a country of, say, 27 million people.
Yeah.
You know, and 3 million
using drugs. Significant enough that there isn't any family that hasn't been touched by it, probably.
This is almost literally true, and that includes my family, my own family, mm-hmm. for example. People have lost loved ones, whole families have been wiped out, people are dislocated. People are made into immigrants, people's gardens, people's animals, the livestock, you know. There's hardly a family that has not paid some kind of a price. Families have been dismembered, you know, families are fragmented, people don't know where family members are. This is, you know, we're tearing the society apart, and that's, I think, criminal.
Oh, it's definitely criminal, because these are not unintended consequences. These are deliberate actions. When we saturation bomb a
yes.
Sewage treatment plant.
Yes.
That is not
yes.
a strategic
yes.
military
right,
goal.
Right, right.
I mean, that is a
yeah.
social engineering
yes.
destructiveness.
Or
there
if
aren't
you
words
use,
to describe.
Yeah. Or if you use drones, for example, at nighttime,
right.
So you have these two insurgents staying with relatives, or staying at a mosque, or staying at a community center. This, there is collateral, quote unquote.
Collateral damage. Yes. And the better good outweighs. The good of the many.
Yeah.
That's wrong. You have to save everybody.
Yes.
You don't get to say, well, five people die, we save the rest. No, yes. You save everybody, yes. Or you didn't do your job.
Yes. And I think another thing that Americans might find interesting is that, you know, the United States, it pays what they call condolence money. So when they kill...
They used to call it indulgence when you paid for your sins ahead of time.
But, you know, so when an Afghan gets killed, somebody has done a report on this, a very detailed precision study. The person, the family is paid anywhere between $2,500 and $5,000.
Yeah, right, for the entire value of that human being, his entire life and his...
And if your cow get killed, this much money. If your sheep get killed, this much money. If your, you know, vineyard is destroyed, this much money.
And you know how... I'll tell you how the planners use that.
Yeah.
They figure, now... Okay, we will have consequences by killing all these civilians, and here's what it will cost.
That's
okay,
right.
That's a lot less than actually doing it the honest and correct way.
Yes.
So let's do it. God.
But it's interesting, you know. Let's say if you killed an American, whether it's a government, a police department, you know, what the compensation would be. In here, because these are Afghans or third world people or people of color or whatever, you know, people
Your
with
Honor,
more power.
I move that we reduce the payment to this man. He's got brown skin. He doesn't need the money like we do.
Yes, yes.
God, racism.
Partly, it's interesting, you know, journalism. You mentioned journalism, but I think there are very few real journalists left in this country. You know, it'll be Amy Goodman and Democracy Now! Or Seymour Hersh or people like that. I don't call Brian Williams David Brooks or, you know... Judy Woodruff or, you know, Mark Shields, I don't call them journalists. I mean, these are just talking heads.
The ones who do try to do real journalism get ostracized or fired or disappeared.
Yes, or discredited. the guy from the Rolling Stones who got killed, remember he did the exposés, I forget his name, in Los Angeles. So, yes, I mean, it's not all that far-fetched or inconceivable that if you really go against the grain in this society in terms of public opinion, the media, or even academia, things can happen to you. You either get marginalized or ostracized or ridiculed or worse. Mm-hmm. So, in other words, the American public does not get the information that it should and that it must. It does not get it from the government. It does not get it from the media, you know, except the alternative outlets such as, say, this one.
Right. And then when you look at it from the conspiracy nut viewpoint, which is, you know, basically just look at the information you have.
Right.
And you see that the elites carefully worked it out so that they have control over the media.
Yes.
They have control over the Congress. They have control over... basically your opinion, and when they control everything at once, they don't have to put very much into it, and now they can belittle you because you're so different from what everybody else thinks is normal.
Yes
That they now have another tool to fight you because you're obviously antisocial,
right?
Because your opinion is so different from all these other honest, decent people.
Yes.
God, and then you try to tell them that what I just said, and now you really are, where's your tinfoil hat?
Yes. Well, I mean, conspiracy, it's a very simple way to silence you or discredit you. Or, you know, but you don't need to be obsessed or paranoid to say that it's a fact that countries do have interests, you know. And it's a legitimate thing. And the United States has legitimate interests and concerns. Other countries have interests, legit. But I think the important thing is, how does a country go about serving its interests?
Or
how does a class of people? Yes.
It's like the TPP. In secrecy?
Right.
You're going to talk about something that affects
everybody in
secrecy?
Right. Yes.
That is dishonest in the face of it.
Right.
You know.
I mean, why is it that the United States State Department has to warn Americans not to go to Afghanistan? But
if you'd been honest,
doesn't have to do that.
Other countries
don't have to do that. Even countries that have military forces there right now. So it must be something about the way the United States goes about serving and fulfilling its interests. That's one thing. Well, the other thing is, I think there's it's called manufacturing consents, mm-hmm. you know, what Chomsky calls.
Right.
It's being said is, in any era, in any society, the ideas of the ruling class become the ruling idea of the time. So there's mm-hmm. an elite in American society, and it's a coalition of elite. I would say it was not just what Eisenhower said, the military-industrial complex. Mm-hmm. I would say that now you have a military-industrial intelligence and media complex. So you have these four segments of the American population. They have a lot in common, and their worldview is very much in common. And they go about, there's no friction amongst the ruling elite, you know. The friction is amongst the population.
That's right. And as long as we keep arguing over all kinds of things, doesn't matter what, we are not talking about how to solve the problem or even identifying what the problem is.
That's right.
And that's the goal.
Yes. You know, I mean, you know, when I come back and when you see things or when you read about our school systems mm-hmm. or when you drive on the roads or when you hear a report that 400 of Oregon bridges need to be replaced or repaired immediately.
And nothing's happening, but we have money to go bomb ISIS somewhere.
Yes, or when you see homeless people, obviously, or when you see people who are really struggling economically, even some of the so-called middle class. This shouldn't be in this country. This country is
a very rich country.
It's a decent, there are a lot of decent people.
They keep showing, the news just yesterday was showing these relieved neighbors who were so glad that the homeless people were ejected as squatters from this house, whatever. Yes. You know, and no story was even mentioned about what do we do with these poor people who don't have a home.
That's right.
And in Portland, Oregon,
we
have as much as 10,000 people that are homeless, and we hide them. Yes. We carefully hide them.
Or we keep pushing them further and further away.
Right, as long as we don't see them,
out of sight.
It's okay.
And you can't feed them in some places now. It's illegal to feed a poor person.
Right, you can't feed a poor person.
Yes, it's amazing.
You know, when I went across Europe in my youth, one of the things that really impressed me was in Paris, France, they had urinals on every corner.
Yes,
public.
Yes.
Places to go to the toilet that anybody could use. You didn't have to be rich.
That's right. That's
and
right.
now, the only way you can go to the toilet in Portland, Oregon is
you have to go
illegally
to
behind a bush,
yes.
or you have to be a landowner.
Yes, yes. So the point is that, you know, and when you come from a place like Afghanistan or any third world country, and you see the vast resources here, and actually the decency of a lot of average Americans,
the
common
people
folks,
themselves,
you know,
people never fight the wars. They never start the wars. Right. It's always a government that wants to have a war.
Yes.
And people don't. I don't want to fight anybody, but my government says I have to go fight ISIS.
Yes.
What?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
And
it's
that doesn't
pity.
Mean you have to have no government, but you have to be aware what your government is doing. If you elect a government as representing you, it darn well better represent you.
Yes, yes.
You know, and
unfortunately, the education system is such that it doesn't make people very intelligent or very critical or even very informed people who have a better picture of the world.
That's not an unintended consequence.
It's miseducation and it's undereducation because true education would be very subversive. You know, it would undermine the class structure.
Right. Anytime
in
you start
America.
Saying, but wait a minute.
Yeah.
If that was true, then wouldn't this be also true? No, you can't talk about that. You're a subversive. Well, no, that's how you use critical thinking.
Yes, yes. And the way this is done in the school system is to put pressure on districts, schools, teachers, students, and parents to just teach to the test.
Well,
no child left behind.
And that presupposes that the test is reasonable, right?
Yeah.
And exactly. My parents were both college teachers, and we've been talking about that for years. How, you know, the teacher who's done all the studying on the subject and is the expert on the subject now has to listen to some stupid politician who says, no, we can't talk about that.
Right.
You know, and so that influences the education. Yeah. And education is supposed to be a tool that you use in your life to make decisions later. And if you're fed this.
Yes. Just teach the test or just teach the test, content without context.
We're having a lot of the good teachers are bailing out because they can't, you know, you can't be happy in your job if you can't do it.
Right, that's right. That's right. So, in other words, the way this the class structure, which is now being globalized, you know, I mean, there's a global class structure. There's a global elite.
Right, we're going to have the same test everywhere.
Yes, but also, you know, to have the same kind of values, have the same kind of food products, have the same kind of clothing, have the same kind of weapons, for example, think the same way, and have the same kind of economic models. That's what Davos is all about.
Conformity.
You know, the Davos conference, the Davos or Davos in Switzerland, yeah. The annual conferences, it's for the international elite. It's to for the international elite how to maintain the status quo globally so that the class structure stays the same undisturbed.
Right.
This is the idea. But the poor people can't get together other than, you know, the World Forum. You know, and not so many people can attend that, you know. So
it's funny, like, consider the Council on Foreign Relations.
Yes.
For a long time, if you even said those words, you were a conspiracy nut.
Yes,
and
yes.
It doesn't exist. It does not exist. Well, now, now it exists,
yeah.
But we're just a group of business guys getting together on a weekend to kick it, you know.
Yes.
And we, sure, we talk about policies, but, you know, we don't have any power, you know.
Yeah.
And now it's admitted that, if you don't, Hillary just said, a year ago or something, she was on her way to the CFR, and they'll tell her exactly what to think.
Yes. Yes.
She said that.
Yes.
I mean, ah!
Yes, yes.
Okay. It's a good thing we know who she's
well,
following.
Well, you know, there are ways of control. I mean, in some countries, let's say if you're in North Korea or Egypt, the control is rather more direct. It's open, it's obvious. You know, they will send you the police, take you away, or, you know, shoot you right there. In other countries, it's more sophisticated. In these nominal liberal Western democracy, so-called, the control is much more sophisticated. It's mind control. It's the control of information.
They make you self-limit.
Yes, it's to you censor yourself.
Self-censor, self-limit.
And or you prevent, you hide the facts from the people.
Yeah.
Hide facts, so the policies.
People, everything the people do, then they think before they do it. Now, how is it going to look to them?
Yeah.
Well, I better not do that because it might be taking. Taken wrong.
Right.
And all of a sudden, without having any guards near you, you're in prison.
Yeah, I mean, I think people need to figure out how they're being managed.
I've seen that happen here
a lot. How they're being governed without knowing. And people need to get much smarter, and people need to put pressure on the system here in the ruling elite to stop behaving like an empire. You know,
one of the
stop plundering and pillaging and killing other countries and people, you know, and behave like
one.
A nation.
Where did we get the idea that we can even decide to do that? I mean, we don't. It's not a choice we have to make, and yet we're doing it. It's like,
well, it's done in our name.
Yeah, murder. It's, well, right.
It's done in our name, which makes Americans look bad. In other words, outside people really think that the American government really represents the American public.
Some,
they don't understand.
I know for a long time you'd always hear him say this. You know. I hate your government, but I love the American people.
Yes.
And what
yes.
they're saying is, I watch American TV and I can relate to the goodness that I see there.
Yes.
Or, you know, the stories. Yes. I don't mean the news, but, you know.
Yes.
But in, you know, every other place that I hear about America, they're sending bombs and killing people and stealing stuff and like that.
Yeah.
And that's the paradox.
Yes. Yes, but many people also believe that this really isn't, although many are cynical, that this is not a democracy, it's a plutocracy. But people who think, many people also think that the American government really represents the American public and speaks for the American public, which is to say that when the American government does something bad in some part of the world, the American public is also blamed for this, you know. They think,
well,
why would you allow your government to do this?
We have a certain amount of, you know, brain dead people who think that they should cheer when we kill somebody, and they do.
Yes.
And then our media highlights them, showing America's favoring what's going on. And they're not showing people like me that are agonized.
Yes.
And also, you know, the Palestine-Israeli thing. They never show the Israeli anti-war people.
That's
ever.
Right. That's right.
And
yeah.
And people don't even know that they exist.
Yeah. Yes. Although there is a strong peace movement in Israel, even in the Israeli military, even the Israeli intelligence community.
When Israel can pretend that barricading medical and food supplies and destroying all the infrastructure, counting calories so that nobody gets to have the enough to maintain a human body.
Yes, yes.
That, and they get to, this is, that's a tragedy enough to do it.
Right.
But to then paint it as if they are protecting themselves from a threat.
Yeah. Yes.
My God, anybody that ever believes that is the most incredible. Oh, I can't, you know, you can't find words to describe it.
Yes. Well, it's a sad commentary on the American public. I mean, I think the public needs to sort of restore its dignity to itself, reclaim its dignity, reclaim its rights, exercise its rights and responsibilities, and relate to humanity throughout the world.
The people watching this show right now are, you know, they all have this decent human attitude. I think people have that in general.
Yes, yes, I do believe
Make your government represent you by becoming decent like you are.
Yes.
Don't allow them, don't sit back and say, what can I do? I'm only one person.
Yeah.
You add your voice together, pretty soon we have this bundle of sticks that you cannot break.
That's right.
You break an individual stick, no problem.
Yes, yes, yes.
So
I think what people need to, in other words, to inform themselves, inform each other, and maybe engage in what is called public diplomacy. In other words, civic organizations in Oregon or throughout America, women, young people, retired people, school teachers, engineers, you know, common people, should try to connect with, say, similar people in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Palestine, in Yemen, in Lebanon.
That's exactly it. They've been, you know, our power structure has been purposely creating a racial conflict, trying to make the blacks think the whites are after them, and the whites think the blacks are after them.
Yes.
And
the Muslims are after the Christians.
Oh, yeah, and the sleeper cells, don't forget
that. Yes, yes, yes.
So what it boils down to, though, is some of the more ingenious countermeasures that people come up with is, you know, get together with that black guy that lives down the street that you've never met.
Right.
Invite him to dinner or something. It's not just like, guess who's coming to dinner, Sidney Poitier.
Yes.
No, it's it's like, excuse me, once you get together, you're not you're not different anymore.
Right, that's right. You discover each other's humanity.
Oh. Excuse me.
So I think that's why, you know, the idea is to sort of divide and rule. Divide the people and rule. And this is done at the national level. It's done at the international level. And people simply need to discover each other, to reach out to each other, to connect with each other, to form communities, responsible communities, and try to put pressure on local, state, regional, and national government to really serve the people, you know, to deliver what they promised during the campaigns, you know, to deliver the party platform. I mean, the problem here is, you know, when somebody gets elected, first, there's a lot of lying. Second, you know, you buy the votes. Third, you are rarely held accountable once you occupy the position, whether it's a school board seat or the presidency. You know, you're not held accountable. And people are out of reach and out of touch. And this is not very good for democratic governance. And this is why people get into government for all kinds of reasons. Then they do all kinds of things domestically and internationally, and they do a lot of damage in the process. You know, somehow Americans need to look into this and do something.
Well, it's the secrecy that makes it all possible. And, you know, we've even had, and now I have a brain fade about the general. Before we went into Iraq, he named seven countries that we already had planned to invade.
Yeah.
And we know that the invasion of Afghanistan was on the president's desk the day before 9/11.
Yes.
And they used that as 9/11 as an excuse.
Yeah.
Right there, I want to point out, if you want to believe that the president was telling you the truth, then you have to believe that they knew about 9/11 before it happened.
Yeah.
That's all there is to it.
You know, we talked about this then. I remember talking about this issue. Many people in that part of the world believe that the decision to invade and attack Afghanistan was made the summer before September of that summer, that year. The same with, and then it was, the choice was whether it would be Iraq first or Afghanistan first. I mean, and many people really don't think that the September 11th thing was concocted or done by, you know, Al-Qaeda or the Taliban. Certainly had nothing to do with, you know, very little to do with 9/11. And then the United States and its allies went ahead and punished the whole country and continue punishing the whole country, people even who were not even born, you know, in September 9/11.
Well, yeah, and then they call it
2011.
It's just collateral damage.
Yes, yes.
We got the one guy we were after, but yes. Yeah, we had to kill the other 800 that were there.
Yes, yes. Well, but
we're sorry.
Remembering, you know, he was also an American creation. I mean, he first worked for the CIA and the Mukhabarat of Saudi Arabia and ISI of Pakistan, because remember, he was running charitable organizations and he was running schools in Pakistan on our behalf, in a way, and he was working with the Mujahideen, of course. He was a Mujahid.
Yeah.
And then Mujahid turned, enemy. And I'm afraid that now the United States getting involved, for example, in Afghanistan, there is the regular army, which is not conscription, but mercenary, you know, they call it professional.
Sure.
But it's a form of work. People enroll in the army, the police, and the intelligence, because this is the only work available.
Yeah, they do that.
But they also, what Americans also have is to create what they call ALP, or Afghan local police. And this is, they would hire these local thugs, essentially. People who are addicts, young and old people who are out of work, are looking for adventure and looking for some income. So the Americans pay for these, what they call Afghan local police. They will give them a weeks of training, and give them uniform and rifle, and then pay them and say, go, you know, fight the insurgents in the Taliban. In many studies, in fact, there's a major report in what is called the International Crisis Group, this organization which is headquartered in Belgium. They just issued a report, and people who are interested in this, reading about the Afghan local police and how someday they will come and haunt the Afghan government and the Americans, because these people are unprincipled. They have no loyalty to anybody other than to themselves.
That's so dangerous.
They're very undisciplined. They're basically gangsters. They're mercenaries, just like some of the Taliban we have done in other countries, first working for us and they're turning against us, you know. But the United States is doing the same thing in Syria now. Can you believe that we do have troops in Syria on the ground?
As long as we can sell arms to both sides, everything's okay.
Well, but you know, some of these people are going to be attacking Americans, you know, maybe five years later.
Then we'll be able to say, see, we were telling you the truth. They are dangerous.
Right, right. Yes.
We go, bam, 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 they're dangerous. Yes. Bam, 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 they're dangerous. Yes. See, they attacked me.
Yes, yes. But this is called the blowback.
Yeah.
I mean, what I'm trying to say is that
the
United States
trilogy
made the same mistake. In Israel, in a way, made the same mistake,
Chalmers,
because Israel created the Hamas. And
right.
I think they created...
And that was in, 1973?
The Hezbollah. I think Israel and the Americans created Hezbollah. And now Hamas and Hezbollah...
That was the same as we did with Al-Qaeda. They have to have somebody to point at.
Yes.
To say, that's why we have to be here.
Yes, yes, yes. Or
and
perhaps if that was not the intention.
Do we have to have college-level people to understand this?
Right, right.
No, I mean, it's in your face.
Yeah, you would think that people would understand this. So what I'm trying to say is that I think U.S. policies, in fact, in Afghanistan or in Iraq or in, say, a place like Syria or even Yemen and Somalia, would someday come to haunt this country or the government, because these very same people who are more or less working on our behalf now could someday turn their guns against America.
Well, not just that, but think about this. All the people that they are betraying by supporting America, they will remember that.
Yes.
If their family gets blown up in a wedding by a drone, they will remember that.
Yes, and those cultures are, what do they call, cultures of revenge.
Yes.
I mean, you're nothing if you don't revenge your brother or your father or your mother or your wife.
And that's exactly what we exploit.
Yes.
And it's so sinister. It people say, you got the cart before the horse. The revenge comes afterward. No, that was planned ahead of time. They did this to get the revenge so that the revenge could be blamed so that we can move in. And
yes.
So the only key, I mean, obviously information and getting together, the regular news isn't going to do it for you. You have to listen to this show and others. And to stop that, they're trying that two-tiered internet thing.
Yes.
Part of the thing is they're saying, okay, you're on a network,
yes,
which is this company's network. It's a private network. Yes. They get to decide the content.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Okay. Well,
I mean, some of this information is available. If you really look hard, you know, there are even in the mainstream press, like if you read the New York Times regularly, or say The Guardian, or say Democracy Now, or the, what we call the alternative media, you know, Common Dreams, The Daily
Beast,
etc. Well,
Democracy Now, although it's probably the best news that is out there, it's now more or less established.
Becoming mainstream.
It's, well, remember that their foundation started during 9-11. I mean, a really important part was during 9-11, and they had to agree not to talk about 9-11 to get their Ford Foundation funding.
Yes.
And Ford Foundation's the economic arm of the CIA, one of them.
Interesting. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Anyway, the point really is that it's American citizens, it's global citizens, it's our duty. I don't think it's a luxury or a choice for one to become informed and responsible and active and involved. I think it's our responsibility.
It's not a luxury, it's
beings.
A duty.
Yeah, okay. It's a duty and it's a responsibility, you know, as human beings living on this planet.
And that's, I mean, that gets back to the where I say I'm not a journalist, I'm a photographer. I want to be out taking pictures of my dog splashing in water.
Yes.
I don't want to spend time learning about the world crisis so that I can tell people, I can tell people that we got to stop it.
But you see, the water could get so polluted that your dog may not be able to, or it will die.
Right, and that'll teach me for not getting involved.
You see? So there are reasons. In other words,
absolutely,
there are practical reasons for us to care about ourselves. Our neighbors,
and by the way,
our
nation,
our species, our planet, because they touch us in one way or another. You know, if we squander gas and oil, the price will go up and will affect us. We can't go to work, you know, or we can't maintain the employment level. So it makes practical sense for people to really get informed
and understand
and
the
behave.
Intricacies of the involvement.
Yes, yes, yes.
And that oil thing, when we invaded Iraq and took over all the oil fields.
Yes.
Well, the first thing that happened was we set them on fire and said Saddam did it.
Yes.
But everybody thought that, you know, they say, well, if we were after their oil, how come we didn't pump it out?
Yes.
Because that's why we took it over, to stop that, so the prices would go up for the bastards that had the oil already.
Right, right. And so that we can have the monopoly.
And
Yeah, so there are a lot of things like that. You know, there are a lot of things like that.
And people buy into the another thing, a duopoly, as Nader calls it, the left-right false paradigm of the Republicans will save us from the Democrats, Democrats will save us from the Republicans, and they're both identical in foreign policy. And foreign policy is what you really have to worry about, because that affects the entire world.
Yes.
And when everybody thought, get rid of Bush. The people, what happened to the war protesters that were standing up against Bush, and as soon as Obama got in and the war increased, those war protesters went away because, oh, it's a Democrat war, we're okay now.
Yes, well,
what?
We have been talking about the duopoly, which has been pretty much true. Now there's a new expression, that is, we're now dealing with two dynasties in America, the Bushes and the Clintons.
Oh, okay, well,
so it's not even so much the duopoly, the parties that matter now. Now you're dealing with these two families competing with each
but
other.
It's always
and you can remember this. Their children would also be candidates for important offices.
What a coincidence.
When they grow up. When
like
Chelsea
the Kennedys
grows up.
And,
yes. Yeah, so we're dealing with two dynasties, each speaking for one of the duopolies.
Well, when you're studying about governments and stuff and you learn about oligarchy and democracy and monarchy.
In other places. It's not in America.
Right, not here.
Right.
Right, exactly.
Right.
And the funny thing is, okay, 320 million people in the United States, they figure that's what, 100 million families maybe?
Yes.
Out of that 100 million families, there's only 1,500 families that control everything.
Most of the wealth.
Yeah.
Yeah, wealth
and
is
they're
incredibly
the ones that cycle in and out of government and in and out of industry. And in,
yes,
you know.
Yes.
But only 1,500 out of 100 million.
Yes.
And our people go around, meh, we have a democracy, meh.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, you know, economists tell us that the concentration of wealth in America is perhaps worse than, say, places like Guatemala.
Yeah, it's the worst Russia of any place, any time South in Africa. History. Any time in history, even yes. all the times that we point yes. to and say, look at those yes. evil people.
Yes. So what we need is progressive taxation.
And what people we need say, is oh, but that would be... That yeah. that would be wealth redistribution. Well, yes, it is. Yes. That's what we need. We yes. want to stop yes. the empire from being yes. passed on to the children.
Yes, yes.
That's so the whole point of taxing somebody at 90%. Yes. It's not because yeah. we don't like rich people. Yeah. It's yeah. because we don't like what rich people do when they have too much money. They spend Fine. It to control your lives.
Yes, I mean, what we need, what okay. we need here is...
Thank you for interviewing me.
Price, price controls, wage controls, that is say, people... Instead of minimum wage, we should be talking about livable wages. What we need is that the wealthy should also proportionately contribute to their social security.
All the way up, not stop at 100,000.
That's right. Yeah, all the way. What we need is a really effective, say, real estate tax, inheritance tax, progressive net worth taxation,
such
as
they have tax?
In Scandinavia.
Have you heard of the Tobin tax? That's where they're going to tax a fraction of a penny on every single transaction on Wall Street. They're livid. They don't want to see that.
Right.
That would generate enough money to completely repair our infrastructure
yes,
and
yeah.
send everybody to college.
Yes.
And,
yes. and
know,
what
no
we need
poverty.
To do is guarantee what we call the safe social safety net.
Right.
That is to say, we need to guarantee every American health, education, housing, and job security.
I always thought it was a strange thing that we call ourselves the greatest country in the world.
It is a great country.
But we refuse
yes.
to help our own people.
That's
the
right.
people of that country yes. don't yeah. deserve our help.
Yes.
What
yes.
Our help? What do you mean our help?
Yes.
Okay.
I keep saying, you know, I love this country, but I don't like the system.
Oh, yeah. It's
you know, the country is a great country. Just drive to the coast and see how beautiful the country
absolutely.
Is.
Absolutely.
Its vastness, its greenness. It's plenty of trees. I mean, only the timber can support the whole planet. It's land that is so fertile. It is a beautiful country, and there are a lot of very good Americans, decent Americans. Honestly, I'm not pandering. I'm not saying this to pander.
You'd have to say
but the system sucks.
Is, pretty much.
You know, the system, the economic system, the political system, the foreign policy system, you know, etc. These have serious problems.
And people think that it's because the people are of the people that are in those systems. Which is partly true, but the people come and go and the system yeah. remains the monster.
The system and the people are interactive. You know, the people make the system, the people system makes the people.
Well,
you know,
I'm
the culture.
Talking like, think yeah. about a corporation that has
yes.
a founding charter, you must make a profit above
yes.
all else. Okay,
yes.
the people can come and go and whether they agree with that or not, that remains. And the same thing with our country.
Yeah.
The good people come and go and they try to do their influence and whatever. But we are still the military might that is going to crush the world.
Yes.
And people
yes.
think, I can't do any.
Well, yes.
We got to find out where that power is coming from.
Yes. Well, or the mindset.
Yeah.
The point is that, you know, we create, obviously, we human beings, we create the system.
Yeah, we never looked at any of
the pictures.
Yeah, we create the system. Yeah, look at this. You know, these people, these are people who have been displaced by floods most recently in Badakhshan. They have been like this for a year now.
Oh, man.
And this is the northeast of the country, which is very, very cold.
But we
you
have
know,
billions of dollars.
They were promised this, they were promised that, etc. This is how they live.
But the government officials there have very good bribes.
Yes, well.
So we're spending our money very well.
Yes. I mean, the amazing thing is like in Afghanistan, when something happens, like say a village gets buried by a snowstorm. An avalanche,
right.
or there's a flood, or something that is an earthquake, a disaster happens. So these people need, because Afghanistan is very mountainous, and these people have no, there are no banks, they don't have savings, they don't have food supplies, they don't have clothing, they don't have, say, clinics and so forth. So you need to get help quickly. The government says, but we don't have helicopters. In the meantime, this is a country where there are still at least 20 bases, and there are hundreds of helicopters.
Right, the military could have
hundreds
just
of helicopters.
Take a few minutes and drop some
That's
food.
That's right. But the thing is, we don't have helicopters, so we can't get help to these people, you know.
You know, as a child, I thought, you know, you hear all the news, and
yeah.
and I thought that we really were trying to go around and help save the world from yeah. every bad thing.
Yes.
And the tool we always used was dropping bombs on something.
Yes.
And
yes.
That I always saw as a child that does not work, no
right.
matter what.
Right.
And I thought, What if we dropped water purification plants on these places?
Or medicine, or clothing, or food.
And then left, and don't stick around to have them say thank you. Just give it to them and leave.
Yes, yes.
And I said, everybody would love the United States.
Yes.
Forever.
Yes, yes.
And we wouldn't have to spend any money.
Yeah.
But I didn't realize the object is to spend the money. That's
so,
the
object. This is the market. Oh. You can see, you know, these are the roads. 3/4 of Kabul's roads are like this. This is, you know, these are Kabul's
roads. And that's
roads.
Probably a good one.
Yeah, yeah. But the other picture, the picture of the palace, I was going to comment on that picture. That is a very interesting picture, this one.
Okay, yeah.
You know, this was built about 100 years ago by King Amanullah, the first modernizing king, and the one who actually gained independence from Britain in 1918 or 1917 or whatever it was. He built this palace, and it's still standing, although you can see it has been bombed countless times.
Right, whatever technology they use certainly stood up to modern bombing.
Yeah, and over on the left is the palace, Taj Beg. It's called Taj Beg. That's where Hafizullah Amin, one of the communist leaders, was assassinated by, you know, the KGB.
And that's why we were bombing.
But the wall you see, this picture is taken from the inside of the American University of Afghanistan.
And that's where you are, just that close.
That's where I am, that close. And this is why, you know, you can see the university, which looks like a prison. This one built. Behind this, you can see another wall that also has barbed wire.
Yes.
So this is one line of defense, the dark thing. This is one wall. And then there's another line of defense with, say, barbed wires and towers, watchtowers with snipers 24 hours a day.
Are they keeping the bad guys out or keeping you in?
Both. Both. Because this is an American establishment, or it has an American name, and there are some Americans working here.
Sure, I can see it being always a target.
We're always a target. I mean, we have a permanent.
This is your graduating class.
Yes, this is like we just graduated cohort for the master's degree. From the master's degree in education. These are all 320 men and women from every single province, 34 provinces. They have their bachelor degrees, and they're all teaching in 2-year teacher training community colleges. So we brought them, and after 15 months, you know, they went through the program, and they received their master degrees on May 17th and went back. So if we can have, this is the American University campus, part of the campus. If we can have maybe 5 groups like this, spend money on these people, train them, they will go and train teachers, the teachers will go and train students.
It keeps expanding.
In about 10 years, you can really turn the entire education system, maybe in the entire nation.
I just can't imagine trying to teach and have the classroom next to you blown up.
Yes.
I mean, oh.
This happens. We have had, in fact, there was an explosion yesterday very near in the university. The university is very close to where the parliament is now.
Uh-huh.
And where the Attorney General's office is, and where there are several important independent election commission, several important buildings and establishments.
So you're kind of in a target zone.
So we're in a target zone, and that's
and
why.
Maybe those drones aren't quite as accurate as they pretend, are they?
Well, we're not yet bombed by drones, but we are, you know, there are explosions, and suicide bombings. And we had this past year, we had more lockdowns on campus than I can remember. Exactly a year ago, just before the second round of election for the presidency, all of the expatriates were evacuated to Dubai for 10 days. We were forced to leave because it got so tense.
Makes it tough to graduate,
doesn't
it?
We tried. This university has 2,500 students. It was founded in 2006, and it's considered to be the best university in the country. But it doesn't get much support. I mean, this university gets very small support from the American government or the USAID. If you could spend the money that you would spend warfare.
The hearts and minds of people get won this way.
Yes.
Not
this is what we should be doing. You know, establish programs, train teachers, train doctors, train nurses, train agriculture extension workers.
But wait a minute.
Yeah.
That would be socialism.
Well, You know, and, this is not a bad idea, actually.
Don't mind that our roads are built by socialism. Yes. Our airports are built by socialism.
Yes.
I mean, but we don't want to talk about it.
But if you want to win hearts and minds, you know, on a permanent basis, then serve the people.
And stop killing
them. And you don't serve them. You don't befriend them by killing them or killing their cows or ruining their crops, etc. I would say establish universities in every province or at least in every region. Build dormitories, build laboratories, install computers, install the internet, teach them English, teach them subjects.
Far less expensive.
Yes.
But,
yes.
You know,
it was estimated that the United States spends on average $1.3 million per soldier in Afghanistan per year. $1.3 million. This university, its entire budget in a year is $20 million. So for the price of 20 soldiers.
One and a half soldiers or something.
Yes, for the price of 20 soldiers, you could have a university like this.
Yep.
They will do a tremendous amount of good.
You know, and somebody once told me that it doesn't make sense that we would spend all this money to go secure the oil when we could have bought it far cheaper.
Well,
no, but the idea was we will spend as much of your money as it takes to make us a profit. You know, it's not if it was our money, then we'd consider that cost benefit ratio.
Yes.
But as long as you're putting the bill.
Unfortunately, we do. Yeah, I mean, we're dealing with a corporate state. It is a sort of a plutocracy, a government off by for the rich.
Yes.
And the public, again, needs to wake up. The public, the American public, you know,
well,
needs
it used to
be
wake
up.
The rich people were smart enough to know that they have to bring the lower people up to a certain level where they stop complaining. But they forgot that now, didn't they?
Yes.
And they're letting Americans now get to that level where, hey, wait a minute, I don't like this. I don't like this.
Right.
And that's the change that's coming because they've now... They've gotten so greedy that they forgot what their parents knew.
Yes.
And that was that you can't take it all.
Right. And I think this is why, I think because there's pushback from the masses in this country, you can see it in so many ways. There is a pushback in one way or another. And that's why I think the ruling elite is sort of retaliating. Look at the militarization of the police force in this country.
Oh, yeah.
And look at what they do on the street, for example. This is an example of pushback from below and retaliation from the top.
We have 1 minute left, and this has been a great interview.
Well, thank you.
I know I'm going to enjoy watching it again. I hope the rest of people enjoy watching it.
Well, thank you for the opportunity. As I said, there's a serious war going on in Afghanistan. We're still spending lives and money. People need to remember this.
But by God, we'll get even with them for 9/11.
9/11
is not that
gone
anymore.
Now. Yeah, 9/11
that
is gone.
That was just our entry.
Let's move on.
Right.
And let's move on and engage in a very sane, rational, decent, collaborative foreign policy where there's something for us, but there's also something for the other side.
And we're human beings. We would work that way if we didn't have some artificial thing stopping us.
Yes. You know? I mean, there's plenty to go around in this country and globally, only if we had a sense of justice and fairness and compassion.
You have to realize, for that richness to exist, there has to be poverty. That is the creation of the rich.
But in the long run, this is untenable. This is the point.
Absolutely.
I mean, warfare, injustice, inequality, you know, is untenable. It's not sustainable.